So our next guest is Fionn Ferreira. He's a 19-year-old scientist that has developed a non-harmful way to extract microplastics from the water. For his work, he was named the grand prize global winner of the Google Science Fair 2019. He's also a science educator and has given more than 300 lectures. He plays the trumpets in the orchestra, and this one kind of impresses me. He has a minor planet named after him. Fionn Ferreira, welcome to the Planetiers World Gathering. Thanks for joining us. Why are microplastics such a relevant problem?
Well, I think that's multifaceted. First, we have to look at, well, microplastics are something that we can't see. And normally we've got the big issue with pollution that at least people can see it. But in this case, we can't see it. So this is an invisible threat. So the first issue with microplastics is that we can't see them. The second issue with microplastics is that they contain lots of different chemicals from wherever they came from. So microplastics can be either added to, let's say, a cosmetic as an abrasive, but they can also break down from larger plastics. And those larger plastics sometimes have colorants full of heavy metals or plasticizers in them, and a whole ton of different chemicals which have a lot of different negative effects on the body. And then the third major problem with those microplastics is that they can biofilms while they're in the water. And biofilms are often toxins that are in the water. And like that, it can bring concentration of toxins. And then finally, another threat with them is that when they get really, really small, like the very, very small microplastics broken down from larger ones or for certain types of biodegradable plastic, which don't perfectly degrade, those ones can be attracted in your gut. They can then be ingested and bioaccumulate in your body. And no one really knows the effects of those.
Mm-hmm. We had a study published here in Portugal about our second largest river. This is Douro River. And that study concluded that on the estuary, there were more plastic particles than fish larvae. So this concentration, this means that it's going to have a big impact on the food chain and on the whole ecosystem?
Yeah, well, I think these high concentrations of plastics in the water are not just harmful for us who live off the water, but of course also all the different plants in the water, around the water, but also the fish and organisms there. And currently there's very, very few studies exactly how this works and the effects that are there. However, most studies that are out there suggest that it's very, very unlikely that these are good for the environment and most definitely having negative impacts on the different biodiversity that we have.
How does the invention that you took to the global to the Google Fair can help solve this problem?
Well, we have to look at the source of microplastic particles, and the source of microplastic particles is multifaceted. Again, there's too many sources, but the major source is wastewater, and that comes from, for instance, cosmetics that have plastic in them, but also us washing plastic clothes like polyester clothes and tiny little fibers breaking off and falling into the water. And then finally, plastics from, let's say, the tires of our cars that get eroded on the roads. So wastewater is a major contributor to this pollution. And currently there's just a major issue that it's really, really difficult to get these tiny plastic particles out. People suggest filtration, like passing it through a sieve or a filter. And because these things are so incredibly small, they're smaller than a lot of other things in the water, it would be incredibly slow to filter water. And even if you were to filter it, you'd still have the issue that a lot of small plastic particles would still get through. So my method uses a mixture of vegetable oil and a powder, magnetite powder. Together it makes this kind of ferrofluid mixture. That ferrofluid mixture is magnetic, and if you mix it with water, it'll stick to the plastics. And like that, I can remove them from water using a magnet. And the benefit of this is that it's not a filter. You don't have to pass it through a sieve. and it attracts the microplastics, meaning that it's a lot quicker and can be applied in a continuous flow environment.
Okay. Okay, so can you scale it?
Yeah, well, I think it's always difficult to look at those things when you're doing a small science project. And I've definitely found it challenging I found it overwhelming to see the different directions that I can take this with. But what I am working on, I'm really excited about, is I've just started building a much, much bigger prototype for continuous flow. So I definitely think that this is a scalable solution for the microplastic issue. I think, however, it's just a preventative or collection measure. And really what we need to all look at is a way that we can stop this pollution from even occurring in the first place. Mm-hmm. But I think to be able to do that, we need to stop using. That's not in the foreseeable future.
Okay.
So yes, I think it's scalable. And I'm currently focusing on drinking water applications as well as wastewater applications.
Mm-hmm. You touched a very important point there. Our economy, our lifestyle, our way of living, it's mostly dependent on plastic. So how can we change this? How can we help solve the problem upstream?
Well, it's a very, very difficult problem, again, to solve, because plastics, in a way, are really, really cool materials. You can do a lot with them. They're flexible, you can make them rigid, you can mold them so easily. The issue is that breakdown. So I think that material science really needs to look at the way they create these plastics, try and create plastics that can break down more efficiently and into components, maybe more base components, which are not harmful to the environment when they break down, and that breakdown quite soon. Mm-hmm. I also think that plastics are an incredible resource that we have. They come from the Earth's oil, and I really feel that applications for them in a single-use environment, it's just such a waste. Oil was refined, polymerized, molded, this huge step process for a plastic bag to wrap whatever you have that you use, and the minute you get home, you open it and throw it in the bin. And I feel that if we do want to use plastic, we really, really need to redesign the way we use it. Treat it like a precious resource. But if we make something out of plastic, we will keep it for a long time, because that's ultimately one of the benefits of plastic, is that it can last so long.
Mm-hmm. So measures like banning single-use plastic, restricting companies from using certain types of plastic, or even banning when we have an alternative material, a more sustainable material to use, these kind of solutions make sense?
Yeah, well, that's what I think. I think that it's always difficult to weigh in between banning and giving alternatives. So sometimes things are banned and there isn't an alternative there yet. But I think that if you combine the innovation of creating a new product that avoids plastic along with a ban, I think then you can really create a society that realizes that there are alternatives to whatever they're using, whether it's a plastic bag or a plastic straw, or much, much bigger applications like the whole hospital plastics issue, or internal company or commercial plastic issues as well, just looking at alternatives there. Mm-hmm.
And do you believe it would be important to make companies more responsible for the pollution they cause by using so much plastic on products? How could that be made?
Yeah, well, I think it's really, really important that circularity gets designed into the products when they are built. And I think companies should be forced to do that. So I think more modular production, or a way that you can separate it easier, would be really useful. Because currently, when you go to a recycling center, those centers basically find it incredibly difficult to determine what type of plastic, what type of colorant, and all the different components added to a specific type of plastic, making it very, very difficult to recycle anything or reuse anything. But I think reuse should be the primary focus here, and I think companies should be forced to implement circularity into the products that they design.
Something no one likes, but might be necessary in this case. higher taxes on the use of plastics.
I think higher taxation on the use of plastics will only make an effect if there's already an alternative there. Because if we tax it higher, often the consumer will not know about that, and they'll just realize that maybe some of their products might be a little bit more expensive. But at the moment, essentially, let's look at the cosmetic industry. Almost all cosmetics are packaged in plastic, which means that if the plastic would be taxed, just all the cosmetics would go up by that plastic price. So I think that unless there's already alternatives there to pack those cosmetics, maybe different solution biomaterials, well, then I think taxation is a really good idea. But if we don't have an alternative yet, well, then I think a plastic tax would not be very helpful. There are circumstances where there is already an the plastic straw or the plastic bag. I think there's no excuse to use something like that if there are alternatives, which there are. So in that case, I think a tax could work very well.
Mm-hmm. I don't know, maybe you've come across some good examples in other countries or in companies. Can you share with us some good examples that you've seen on addressing this issue?
Yeah, well, whenever I go to Portugal, one thing I really, really strongly notice is that whenever I go to a major shop, let's say Continent or Jumbo or any of your stores, I really find that plastic bags are really, really common, and everything's wrapped in plastic. And I find it actually very rare to see people using reusable bags or bags like that. So I think that's on a consumer scale. But then we can also look at the bigger scale, what's being sold to those consumers. And many countries are really promoting, particularly supermarket chains, are really promoting the use of non-plastic alternatives. So in cosmetics, products that don't have microplastics in them, or for instance, the use of paints that don't shed plastic, or the promotion of clothes without plastic in them. But I really find that I found it difficult in certain countries to find things like that. So I think a step that any country can do is to really promote that and try and highlight it to the consumer in what they're buying. But I also feel that there's a legislation point that can be implemented as well in the side of public works and public affairs as well, which are huge plastic polluters. For instance, if you look at the whole hospital industry, the single use is huge there. And we can see, for instance, here in the Netherlands, where a lot of those things are converted to paper or recyclable. I'm still saying here it's very, very bad still. But at least there's a push to the right direction. And I think that if that were applied more here and in other countries, that could make a difference.
Some argue that recycling and even incineration is not really a solution because we're not really trying to reduce the consumption of plastic. There are some numbers. From also Greenpeace has numbers that the use of plastics has seen a tremendous growth. From the 1950, we had 1.7 million metric tons, and in 2015, 322 million tons. So we need to reduce, not necessarily recycle or incinerate.
Yeah, well, I think that, however, plastic and the whole crude oil area is something useful. I really disagree with incineration, because I think that incineration of plastic will promote the making of more plastic, and it'll almost give people an excuse to think that it's okay to throw away plastic because we can get energy from it. And I really think that incineration is not a clean process and not a viable way to get rid of our plastic pollution. Mm-hmm. I also think, however, that recycling as well has its downfalls, because it creates, first of all, again, that feeling of security. Well, it's okay to buy plastic because it'll be recycled. But also, it takes an incredible amount of energy to heat up that plastic, to melt it, to recycle it, and that's quite difficult and still quite energy intensive, so quite a big carbon footprint. Yeah. So what I think is a very, very big alternative that really needs to be considered more in the design of products and the disposal of products is reuse, a way that we can make products more modular, that they can be taken apart, that those parts can be reused without major amount of energy having to be spent on that reuse, and try to avoid the recycling stream as much as possible.
Mm-hmm. Innovation is also a key to solve this problem, as you showed with your invention. Where can we innovate to help this problem? What areas may help?
Well, that's a really good question. And I think that anybody here listening to this immediately has the power to innovate, because what I really, really feel is important in innovation is, first of all, to play a little bit, to have a bit of a free, imaginative, creative way about you, maybe take a childlike aspect to the way you approach the problem. So I think, first of all, something to note here is that anybody can make a difference if they have a crazy idea. And if they try it out, they might realize that it's not quite so crazy. Areas that really require innovation, I think, are the whole plastic sector, particularly on materials design, but also we really need innovation on the idea of reuse, how you can make a product that can be reused for longevity, or also hugely on the idea of alternatives, because ultimately we want to be free from these petrochemical plastics and ideally bioplastics as well, to a point where we don't need to use plastic, where we can use completely different alternatives. And innovation is really required there. And I think, as we've seen, these ideas often don't come from people who have studied this topic for many, many years. And really anybody can come up with these ideas.
Mm-hmm. One thing you also talk about is that you believe a childlike mindset is key to solving problems. Can you elaborate a little bit on that?
Yeah, well, firstly, I have to make a major view, and that is that I love playing and building things. The other major confession I have is that most of the things I play with or build don't really work, or really don't work, they fall apart, or sometimes catch fire. The ones that catch fire are fun, though, I like those. And I think that everybody should make in their lives to play a little bit, to try things out, to maybe go with something completely unconventional and just see where it takes you, a completely unconventional idea. Mm-hmm. And the reason how I came up with my was just because I was playing with things in science that I enjoyed. The first thing I enjoyed was ferrofluid, getting liquid. The next thing I liked was building machines to measure things about the environment. I lived really close to the coastline in Ireland, and because of that, I just loved being out kayaking and was really, really annoyed to see all these plastics lying around. So I made a machine to measure microplastic concentrations in water. So then what I did was I also looked at ways I could remove these microplastics from water. It didn't really work. And then I thought, well, what happens if I throw some ferrofluid in with plastic and try and get it to stick to these plastics? And that was a really weird idea. Ferrofluid is something that you'd never really associate with water cleaning. And that was just me dabbling around, mixing things together, just trying things out. And I think that that play-like aspect, where you're not exactly expecting it to work, but it might work, is something that will create something completely unexpected that people haven't thought of. And ultimately, I think that is what innovation is. So although I still study now in university, I'm studying for my bachelor in chemistry, I still make time every single day to play. I've got my box of Lego just in the corner over there. I really, really like playing with that, with ideas, building machine ideas that I have. Sometimes they work, sometimes they don't, and sometimes they manage to trip the switch for all the electricity in the house. But that's on a rare occasion.
Okay. Fionn, thanks very much for being with us. It was quite enlightening. And thanks for your innovation spirit that was here today with us. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye. Thank you. Bye-bye.